side, Alyssa Horace from Mudwalt Arena, where it's going to be lively. It's going to be lit here today as Arkansas takes on Kentucky, the number 10 ranked team in the country. Kentucky coming off a loss to South Carolina. That was 81-78 at the buzzer.
Win by 20. So, Alyssa, when you look at this, it's a 3 p.m. tip today on ESPN. Dickie V is in the house. We all know it's going to be electric. Arkansas trying to snap a seven-game losing streak in this series.
Yeah, it's an exciting atmosphere we got in here, and the students are already here. I'm going to try maybe if I can to turn around the camera here, but it is a student section that is already packed, and we still have 45 minutes left until tip-off. Such a big game for Arkansas when you look at this matchup with Kentucky, because they played Kentucky a few times in big games. When you look at SEC championship games, you see here what they did in 2013 with the Quals put back up.
Yep.
They then turned around and beat them at Kentucky the very next year. But outside of those two instances, as you mentioned, it's been a seven-game losing streak. So can Arkansas, with the momentum they have right now, the way that Eric Musselman's got them playing, can they get over the hump and beat Kentucky?
Let's take a look at the matchup yet again as Arkansas will take on the Kentucky Wildcats. Now, when you look at this, this is a four-way tie we have right now in the SEC for second place. So critical when you look at what Arkansas could do under Eric Musselman here today, not only to snap that streak we talked about, a seven-game skid, but also when you look at Kentucky just suffering its first loss in SEC play the other night at South Carolina Colonial Life Arena. So as we take a look at the matchup, Arkansas on ESPN will take on the Kentucky Wildcats, coached by John Calipari, longtime coach of the Kentucky Wildcats. And we do have some sound as well to get to as Jimmy Witt talked pregame. And also, you know, the fact that Arkansas has an opportunity here to beat a team that we all know is a blue blood in college basketball. But Arkansas is tradition rich as well. We all know that. Great matchup. Let's hear some pregame sound.
Going to come in ready. Each game is individual of the last. No matter how good or bad you did the game before, it's a new game. So we know they're going to come in fired up because they don't want to drop two in a row. So we know we're going to have to prepare, start preparing a little bit tonight, really start getting in the heat of it tomorrow and just prepare for a dogfight, which we know it's going to be.
As much told us after the game, they're a good dribble drive team. So, you know, I know he's going to prepare us for that tomorrow. And I'm ready to play him, you know, because Musk's not scared of nobody. We're not scared of nobody. We're not going to back down because it's Kentucky.
We just got to score.
Okay, so, you know, when you look at this matchup, what's it going to be all about? Everybody's talking about the lack of size for Arkansas. We've heard it all season long, but Arkansas with just two losses on the season somehow should be at this point probably undefeated, because we know what happened against Western Kentucky, 86-79 loss in OT in Bowling Green, two-point loss at LSU, a game where Arkansas was out-rebounded 53-24. But in this game, really, as you hear Eric Musselman talk about it, it doesn't seem like there are any weaknesses for Kentucky. Surely, it's really hard at this point to really pinpoint one.
Yeah, you know, what are you going to do when you look at a Kentucky team and try to figure out how to beat them? We saw South Carolina do it at their place on Wednesday, so it's doable. It's happened before, and they have already lost back-to-back games already this year, losing to Utah and then losing to Ohio State earlier in the non-conference schedule. But I think what happens when you talk to Eric Musselman, Arkansas needs to play how Arkansas needs to play. Don't worry about what Kentucky does. You know, it was funny, he was asked about, you know, how Kentucky thinks about Arkansas, and he goes, well, that's a question for John Calipari. I don't know how Kentucky thinks about us. I don't really know what Kentucky has, you know, in favor of them. So I know what my guys can do, and I know what I can control, and that's making sure that his shooters are on point. We saw Mason Jones make 1 point in their last game. He has got to be hot. He's got to be able to shoot the ball, as is Isaiah Joe. Jimmy Witt's got to be there as well, because you know Kentucky will probably do what LSU did and attack the glass. Reggie Chaney needs to step up well. Adriel Bailey needs to step up. But if Arkansas wants to stay in this game and make it competitive and really have a chance to win, which I think that they do, you got to get your shooters on board.
Yeah, it's a great point about Reggie Chaney, because he had 14 against Vandy. But I think you look at that and you say, all right, is Arkansas going to play what they typically play, seven or eight guys? That's probably going to happen, but fouling, that's a big part of this, because Eric Musselman can ill afford to have his key guys getting foul trouble here today. Same goes for John Calipari, but when you look at Calipari's club, that team typically plays about nine guys.
Yeah, exactly, and I think that, you know, what's also really funny with Eric Musselman, and he talked to us about this too, is he's got a formula, and so far that formula works of playing a limited amount of guys. He doesn't want to play his whole entire bench. He's going to play six or seven. So it's worked for him. It's the depth. He said no one's going to out hustle us. You're not going to wear us down. You're not going to tire us out. And I think that that's going to play in Arkansas's favor because these guys have been playing 30-plus minutes this whole entire season.
We talked about rebounding. When you look at John Perry's team, you know, it's a deal where defensive rebounding-wise, Eric Musselman talks about that so much. Can Arkansas hang around and get enough defensive rebounds? Because Kentucky's pretty good in that area, but that's the thing. You don't want them to be able to play that volleyball around the rim that we saw LSU do, and that's where you're a little concerned in a game like this. Why? Because Kentucky has a guy like Nick Richards, and Richards, as Musselman alluded to, is a double-double machine. So not only can they go with Richards, who is a starter, but they can really go into their bench. They can throw 6'7", 6'9", 6'11", at you.
Yeah, well, hey, look, get those second-chance points out of here. I don't want to see them, right? That's where Arkansas hurts themselves the most, is the defensive rebound, offensive rebounds by the other team, and those second-chance points are going on the other side of the scoreboard. So I really want to see them cut down on that. And they're going to Arkansas has been playing bigger than they are this whole entire season. My whole thing is right now, as we sit here and dissect these teams, is don't play above yourself. This team is good. They're gritty. They play with a chip on their shoulder, and they're confident. And if this team can play the way we've seen them this year, this is a win for Arkansas. This isn't a David versus Goliath game anymore. This Arkansas team can easily win this ball game.
You look at stats, Arkansas is leading the SEC in steals, leading the SEC in turnovers forced. We saw at Ole Miss, for instance, this past Saturday, where Arkansas got in a hole but dug out of it. How? Well, they're able to create by getting those steals, forcing turnovers, and then they get in rhythm, because if somebody's up in your grill and they're blocking your shot, or they're at least contesting and getting that high hand up like Kentucky can do as well, because Kentucky's a pretty good defensive team as well. Arkansas is elite defensively. And you are concerned with those things in that regard, but Arkansas is able to, off those steals or off those turnovers, be able to create, and they got those points off turnovers in high volume at Ole Miss, for instance. Ole Miss different than Kentucky, but they were able to get that separation to where a guy like Isaiah Joe gets just enough to get that quick release going, and he can fill it up.
Oh, yeah, it's really nice to see. It's funny. I'm sure you guys heard the boos. Kentucky was going off the court, and the student sections were booing them as they were. I mean, the excitement, the atmosphere is going to be great right now. I'm excited to see how this crowd fills out. You know, again, we've got about 37 more minutes.
Yeah.
I'm going to see if I can go road Drew and
okay.
The camera around. We're gonna bear with us, but we want to show you what this looks like from our standpoint over here. This is what we're looking at right now in terms of how the student sections are filling out. Everyone's pretty much ready to go. Fans filing in. There was a line around Bud Bowl Marina as the fans waited to get in. They opened up the doors about an hour and a half before the game, but the students had been camping out, Drew, since 6 a.m.
Yeah.
I wasn't even awake at 6 a.m., so it's impressive. I remember when I was 20 and I could do stuff like that, right?
Yeah, I'm no longer there as well.
Yeah, no, I was trying to get as much sleep as I could, but you got to commend them. They are here just like they said they were going to be. They've got their must-bust shirts on.
Yeah.
And it's pretty cool. I'm really excited, you know, something away from the game, to see this atmosphere.
Yeah.
We've seen it before. I was here in 2013 with the Quals put back dunk, but it's hard to beat a full Bud Bowl Arena.
Yeah, and I know we got some comments coming in as well, but, you know, when you think about the fact that you alluded to the atmosphere, I guess Texas A&M, Arkansas had 19,200 in here. And, you know, this feels like it's back to the old days. I mean, Mike Anderson, during his 8 years as head coach, was able to get some pretty strong electric crowds in here, as I mentioned previously, but there's something about the way this fan base has embraced what Eric Musselman has been able to do in a short time. He got here in April, and the way this team has been able to gel, and chemistry-wise, whether it's the pool parties, as I mentioned, at Musselman's house, or just what he's doing on social media. Let's talk about that, because you have to have that connection. Why? Because not only is it great for you team-wise, but to sustain the long haul in a season. Guys get sick, guys get injured. And when you get into the second season, which is the SEC tournament, and then the third season, which is the NCAA tournament, if you're fortunate to get there, that chemistry, all that more important.
Absolutely. You know, this is I was impressed when Musselman came in here and didn't really lose a lot of guys. I was worried that a lot of these guys would leave and transfer out after Mike Anderson was fired, and they didn't. They stayed because Musk made him believe, and he's making him believe since he got here. They trust him. They trust his system. They like being coached hard. This is what I love too. You talk about the social media interaction,
yeah,
and that chemistry. You know, you can have a coach who wants to come in here and be a part of Arkansas so much that they're doing these videos and they're giving shout-outs to the tennis teams getting their season started and making crazy videos, but yet you don't see the product on the court or on the field. They're in your face, they're excited, but you don't see the product on the field. What Musselman has is he is winning on the court, and he's winning the social media game. He's winning over these fans. He's winning over these students. He's winning over these coaches. He's like best friends with the Van Horns. I mean, I love it. I love how much Musselman has integrated himself, his family, into this community, and it has been paid off dividends since he stepped on campus.
Let's go back to the stats, because interesting that you look at the three-point shot, how impactful that could be. Arkansas could really shoot it. But when you look at Kentucky, even though we know that Arkansas is the best in the SEC, the best in the country at defending the three, this is a Kentucky team that does not shoot the three as much. And if you look at the SEC stats, they're the team with the fewest threes attempted. So they're going to go inside. They're going to grind it. You would think more and more they would try to do that. And the dribble drive offense under Cal lends itself to what? Ashton Hagans, what he can do, because Hagans leads his team in assists. Tyrese Maxey is their leading scorer, but they have really good guard play, and that's going to be a great matchup as well. Obviously, we know post play, you're probably not going to have that dunker spot that Musselman talked about pregame. Jimmy Witt got those easy dunks. Reggie Cheney was fighting hard the other night against Vandy. Those were open lanes where they had dunking areas around the block, but you're probably not going to have that as much here today. Why? Because of Kentucky's length.
Right, exactly. And they're going to have to be able to move the ball. That's what moving the ball is going to do. It's going to open up some of those lanes because you catch Kentucky in transition or trying to switch. It's not Vandy. They're not going to accidentally open up the lane for you. So you've got to play a little bit better. You've got to be a little bit more direct and strict with your movements. And it's going to be a fun ball game. I'm excited to see how that length of Kentucky matches up with the scrappiness and the speed of Arkansas. It's a winnable. I keep saying it, but it's a winnable game for Arkansas, and we haven't been able to say that against a Kentucky team, I think, at least in the past couple of matches.
Yeah, you know, Kentucky's going to be hungry. We know that because they just lost, obviously, at the buzzer, but also because of what they allowed in the second half alone against South Carolina. They allowed 56 points in that second frame.
Yeah, I was not happy yesterday.
Yeah.
At his six-minute press conference. It was pretty funny. He was not happy. He just came in, kind of ranted for a bit, and then walked off.
Yeah, he's like, sorry I got here late, but there's a lot to shore up because we gave up 56 at South Carolina. But that was a game where Kentucky started strongly, at least by this standpoint. They got up 8-0 early, and South Carolina was just two of its first 15. So, you know, shooting-wise, you go through those spurts, but that's what I'm going to look for here. You know, you talk about a game of runs, and, you know, Eric's dad, who is an NBA coach, obviously, always talks about how there's three phases to a game, three runs, and can you sustain one of those, perhaps, to where you can hold on to win the game? But how are you going to fare in those three runs, so to speak? So I think that's a huge part of this, because Arkansas can come out, the crowd could be electric, like I mentioned, and they can get out to a 10-2 advantage, but are you going to wear down? Now, I think conditioning-wise, this is as good as I've seen, really, in a while at Arkansas. I mean, the way this team is conditioned, we see basically you got four guys playing at least 30 minutes per game. So this team, they're not going to get tired, Arkansas that is. But are you going to get enough, if you do get into foul trouble, as I mentioned at the outset, from the guys that are the sixth, seventh men?
Yeah, that's going to be hard, and they got to be careful, because we've seen it where, you know, you go back to LSU and Reggie Cheney gets four fouls in 5 minutes. You cannot let that happen early in the game, especially with Reggie Cheney, with Adriel Bailey, and that might be part of Kentucky's game plan, is attack them early to try to get those fouls up so that he can't play Reggie Cheney as much as he might want to, or get Adriel Bailey in foul trouble. Even we've seen Isaiah Joe in foul trouble once this year, so that's what I bet Kentucky tries to do, but Arkansas has got to respond.
Yep, and you got to get Mason Jones going. As you mentioned, the other night against Vandy, at halftime, Mason Jones, Isaiah Joe were scoreless in that game against the Commodores. And
yet they still. Player of the game?
What's that?
You have a player of the game?
That's tough. I mean, I've been racking my brain with a prediction alone in this game. You know, I think I'm going to go with Mason Jones. You know, I was really thinking of somebody off the bench in this one who could be an X factor. You look for that, but I feel like Mason Jones is going to be resilient coming off that performance where he only had 1 point. He did some things otherwise that were not looked at as much. Assists, you know, some of the things, his intangibles, you know, are overlooked sometimes when he doesn't score as much. But this guy, you know, he's leading them in rebounds, steals, points, you know. There's so much that Mason Jones does for this team. Do you have any idea what your prediction is for this game? Because we want to know. Tweet at us. Get on Facebook. Let us know because, you know, this is a deal where Arkansas is only allowing teams to score about 61 points per game. Kentucky only gives up about 64 points per game. So that's the thing. That's why I think, for me, it's so hard to predict the final score.
I'm going to make the students happy. I'm going to say Arkansas at least gets to 70 points and everybody gets free chicken. There's my score prediction.
Okay. All right. That's fair. That's kind of a compromise, but I'll take it. I like it.
Everybody gets free chicken. All right. And by the way, I love the Mason Jones pick. I was going to do that as well. I was talking to my husband earlier before the game, and, you know, Mason Jones is due, but I'll take his counterpart. I'll take Isaiah Jones.
Okay.
Because I feel like we're pretty good with picking one of those guys.
Yeah, top two scorers right there. That's where we're going with the players of the game. We'll see. Let us know what you think, and thanks for joining us here in pregame in the Big Trail Nation. Arkansas, Kentucky at 3.
For watching this Pig Trail Nation report.